Hello everyone, I am Shraddha Shetty and today I am going to talk about my BTech project, Fingerprinting Therapeutic Proficiency of Flu Analyte Analogs, Apprenticing in Silico and In Vitro Tools Against Breast Cancer, performed under the guidance of Professor Mala Parab and Professor Pramod Kumar Gupta of D.Y. Patil University, School of Biotechnology and Bioinformatics, Navi Mumbai, and Professor Santosh Chhajor, MED, Nasik. Let me start by giving you an introduction to the topic. Cancer, the second most leading cause of death, has become the biggest epidemic of the 21st century across the universe. Breast cancer is the second most common cause of morbidity and mortality in women. Globally, 23% of the entire cancer cases and 14% of the cancer deaths are due to the breast carcinoma. According to the Globalcon 2018, the incidence rate covering 154 countries is 11.6%, and the rate of death was about 6.6% covering 103 countries that was conducted by the International Agency of Research on Cancer. Even though there are available existing drugs in the market, such as tamoxifen or olotenib, there are several drawbacks that come along with it. And hence, there is a need of new improved inhibitors of EGFR to overcome these existing gaps. So the present research study ventures to synthesize potential structural derivatives of analytes that have enhanced effect as anti-cancer molecule with less toxicity, higher specificity, potency, and affinity to target the EGFR signaling pathway by synergistically blocking the cancer cell escape and minimize the emergence of resistance and chemotherapeutic cost. So the first aim is to design the analyte analog, that is to identify the potential analyte analog on the basis of their binding efficacy within the pocket of the potential receptor target, that is the EGFR. And we can find that by in silico molecular docking. Synthesis of the highest affinity molecule with comparison to the standard drug identified by in silico laboratory work and scrutinize its purity. Toxicity prediction of the synthesized compounds by online servers to biologically evaluate the potency of synthesized flu molecules of the analyte analogs against human lymphocytes and breast cancer cell line MCF7. Cytotoxicity testing of the compounds to be checked by MTT assay and calculating its IC50 value and statistical validation of the data. So what exactly is breast cancer? So breast cancer is uncontrolled growth of malignant cell, that is a formation of lump or mass in the mammary epithelial tissue. It is caused because of the dysregulation of different signaling pathways. They're classified into two broad categories, that is breast carcinoma and breast sarcomas. Breast carcinoma occurs in the lobules and terminal ducts, whereas breast sarcomas are very rare and they arise from the stromal components such as the blood vessels and myofibroblasts. There are three different types, that is non-invasive, invasive, and metastatic. Non-invasive is the ductal carcinoma that develops inside the pre-existing normal ducts. Invasive grows surrounding the breast stromas outside the ducts and the lobules, and they are of two types, invasive ductal and invasive lobular. And metastatic is the last stage which spreads to all the organs of the body, that is found in the lymph nodes, armpits, lungs, liver, bone, and brain. How can you identify if you are prone to breast cancer? By signs and symptoms. So that include lungs or thickening around the breast, swelling of any part of the breast, change in the size, shape, appearance, redness, swelling, nipple bleeding or lymph node visibility, a newly inverted nipple, etc. So the risk factors could include genetic factors such as in genes that could include BRCA1, BRCA2, TP53, etc. Family history being female, hormone replacement therapy, menopause, obesity, lifestyle changes. Diagnostic would include breast ultrasound, breast examination, and depending on different stages, it would include blood tests, bone scan, CT scan, etc. Treatments could include surgery, that could be lumpectomy, mastectomy, and sentinel node biopsy. Radiation therapy causes cancer, like cancer cells are basically killed using a high-powered beam of energy, such as X-rays. Chemotherapy is use of drugs, and this is a systematic therapy. Hormone blocking therapy, some patients are like sensitive to hormones, so medication that would block this hormones from attaching to the cancer cells. Targeted therapy, drugs that focus particularly on the protein receptors such as EGFR and HER2, etc. So what are the research gaps? So basically, EGFR belongs to the family of protein kinases. So it is the fifth largest gene family with 518 members and 106 pseudogenes. They have roles in metabolism, transcription, cell division, and movement. So they basically transfer the gamma phosphate from the ATP, and that is the amino acid with three hydroxyl group from the protein substrate. So the transfer of phosphate from phosphoprotein to a water molecule. They are an attractive drug targets because of this dysregulation occurring in various illnesses such as cancer, diabetes, nervous disorders, etc. So example would include imatinib, which was the first FDA-approved drug in 2001 for leukemia. EGFR. Now, EGFR is an epidermal growth factor, that is the binding of a protein to a ligand that induces receptor dimerization and tyrosine osteophosphorylation and leads to cell proliferation. So basically, mutation in this gene is associated with the various cancer overexpression. So epidermal growth factor is activated when it binds to specific ligands such as EGF and TGF-alpha. Now, upon the activation of EGFR, it undergoes transition from inactive monomer to an active homodimer. After it is activated, it stimulates intrinsic protein, and as a result, autophosphorylation of several tyrosine residues in the C-terminal domain of EGFR occurs, which elicits the downstream activation such as cell proliferation, inhibition of apoptosis, angiogenesis, etc. Now, what would EGFR inhibitors do? They will compete with the ATP to bind to the catalytic domain of the kinase and inhibit the EGFR autophosphorylation and this downstream signaling. Analytes. Analytes are the acyl derivatives of aniline that are highly studied organic compounds of various biological activities such as antifungal, herbicides, antibacterial, and anti-cancer. Benzaanalytes and thiobenzalites, after literature surveys, are found to be promising scaffolds for various biological activities, including anti-cancer ones. So what are the different research gaps that were identified? So it would include drug resistance, high chemotherapeutic cost, low binding affinity, side effects, dysregulation of EGFR downstream signaling effect, and relapse after initial response. How was this research carried out? First, by in silico approach. EGFR domain, that is the protein sequence, was obtained from the UniProt database in its FASTA format. Homology modeling was performed to obtain its 3D structure using Swiss model. The best code model was downloaded and it was separated from its ligand using BioVia DS visualizer. To obtain a stable conformation of the model structure, energy minimization was carried out using GROMAX. XmGrace was used to visualize the potential energies of the model, and the quality of the model was checked using PyMOL and further validated by PROSAWeb and SAVES 5.0. Multiple sequence alignment and cluster omega was used to determine the active sites of the docking along with CASP 3.0. And molecular docking of 9 molecules of benzaanilides with halogen substitution was done using autotoc BINA. Synthesis of compounds, it was done by Scottmann-Bowman reaction. That is 0.01 mole of p-chloroaniline and p-bromoaniline was taken into an iodine flask, and 20 ml of the 10% aqueous sodium hydroxide solution was added. The contents were swirled constantly, and dropwise 0.01 molar of the benzyl chloride was added. After the complete addition of benzyl chloride, the contents of the flask was kept aside for 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, the reaction was neutralized using concentrated HCl hydrochloride, and then after the final crude compound was formed, it was filtered off using Wattmann filter paper and dried for 24 hours. The air-dried particles were recrystallized for purification from the boiling ethanol, and it was air-dried again. Toxicity prediction was done using Swiss ADME and ADMETSA. The in vitro approach, the MTTSC was performed in 96 well-water microplates. using MCF7 and human lymphocytes. MCF7 breast line was maintained in CO2 incubator at 37 degrees Celsius along with DMEM, FBS and antibiotic. And statistical validation was done using GraphPad Prism 8.4.3 for IC50 values. So the further results and discussions. So EGFR domain, like I said, was derived from UniProt database, which is of a human origin and was obtained from the entry ID P00533. The domain sequence ranged from anywhere from 712 to 979 of a length of 268 with 1,210 residues. Homology modeling was done to obtain the model, and it was selected based on the eye similarity and X-ray resolution, that is 1.4 angstrom to 2.7 angstrom. There was total of 22 templates that were searched based on the query sequence. And the model that was selected was of a PDB ID 1M17, which had a ligand AQ4 that was olotinib. And the GMQ score that was obtained was 0.98 and Q1 score of minus 0.89, indicating that this model could be further used and it is of a good quality and reliable structure. But before going to the molecular docking, it is necessary to energy minimize the model. So the selected model had a high identity template, and like I said, the GMQ score, the QME score was 0.8. And local estimate prediction was done to understand if the model was of good quality or not. Further, the model was energy minimized using GrowMax. And why is that to be done? Because there could be any structural errors that could be included in the model. So to overall improve the accuracy of the structure during docking, GrowMax 5.0 software was used to obtain an electroneutral system and no steric clashes, which was carried out using OPSLA force field and was set to 1 lakh steps. The potential energy was also determined. The quality of the energy minimized was checked in terms of RMSD value by the PIMOL tool. The RMSD value that was calculated was 0.210, which indicated that the structure was closely related and was of a good quality. So by superimposition also, we understand that the RMSD value, that the model that was selected had a good quality and further it could be used for docking. Model was further validated using the ProCheck and ProsaWeb service, and the Ramachandran plot stated that the 3D model had about 88.9% of the residues and 11.1% in the allowed region and zero in both the generously allowed and disallowed regions. And before refinement, it had 88.5 residues in the most favored region and 11.5 residues in the additionally allowed region. Further, by the IRAD that is used for spotting the errors in the folded region and to check the reliability, it was found to be 94.01%, which was greater than 50, hence indicating that the model was of good quality, having higher resolution and had insignificant errors and could be further used for docking. And the 3D similarity, that is verified 3D for the refined model, was found to have a pass from the server, and 96.27% was the residue that was 3D to 1D score, which signifies the structural similarity, which was well matched and of high quality. So the ProsaCheck analysis gives us a Z-score value, which was found to be minus 6.82, and it was within the acceptable range of minus 10 to 10, which hence again gave us that the model was of good quality and can be further used for docking. So the active site was predicted by CASP along with multiple sequence alignment that was done So by CASP, we got to know that the pocket had a size of area of 306.524 and a volume of 599.9, and a total of 60 amino acids were predicted to be at the active sites for the protein model. But we went in a very different way. So the main identification of the actor site was done using the multiple sequence alignment that was done using Cluster Omega server. In the study, the active sites was analyzed in terms of the position of the interactive pharmacophoric amino acid residues that was identified by the lick plot, that is the protein ligand interaction that was again found by PDB sum for the PDB ID of the model, that is 1M17. So after the multiple sequence alignment, we could find the favorable sites of the docking that had higher similarities that was found. So which included leucine, alanine, as further shown. After selecting the active site and the molecular docking was performed using the AutoDock tools and AutoDock DNA. And after performing the molecular docking, we understood that the synthesized the compounds that could be synthesized could be A and B that was found to have the adopting similar orientation of the reference allotinib within the active site. As you can see, the N4-chlorophenyl benzide had and the N4-bromophenyl had more binding affinity than the ligand that was present in the model, that is allotinib, and they have the same receptor in the same cavity and with the extra binding. As you can see, the binding energies was found to be 6.8 and minus 6.9 with respect to allotinib, that is minus 6.6. And the parent allotinib had displayed the interaction with the MET-769, while the compound A shows a strong interaction of MET-A-742, that is a strong pi sulfur bond that is forming. So further, these two were synthesized. By in silico toxicity by Swiss ADME, we understand that the output from Swiss ADME is like divided into four sections, that is divided into different sections like physicochemical properties, lipophilicity, pharmacokinetics, drug likeness, and medical chemistry. So the number of hydrogen bonds would range and should be accordance with the rule of Lipinski of phi. So we can see that the synthesized compound A and B has somewhere minus 3.68 and minus 3.99, which indicate that they are highly soluble and better in the rest of the compounds. The pharmacokinetics observable value also indicate that they have a higher gastrointestinal absorption, they are blood-brain permeant. Also, the compounds obey the rule of Lipinski of 5. Overall analysis indicate that compound A and B had adequate biological features with less toxic effects, and hence they were considered hopeful druggable candidates for human EGFR towards moderating the breast cancer and also inhibiting their biological significant pathways. The Egan-Boyle-Decht is a graphical representation that is shown here, that is for the passive gastrointestinal absorption and brain penetration in function to the position of the molecules. WLOCP versus TIPSA referential. So the white region that you can see is representing the high probability of passive absorption by the GI tract, and the yellow region is for the high probability of brain penetration. So as we can see that all the molecules were predicted as actively fixed by the PG plus that is indicated, and in the red that is indicated as the non-substituent of PG P minus. So the compounds are in the YOP region depicting high probability of brain penetration, and they are a non-substrate of PGP minus as predicted by the red points. Further, for compressive analysis of toxicity and chemical properties, we use the ADMET-SAR web tool, which indicated like 50 endpoints in depth and the ADMET properties, that is the absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion, and toxicity. And these show that they were the non-substrate of PGP, and in terms of metabolism, they are found to have inhibitors of CYP1A2 and CYP family, And the synthesized compounds also showed that they're water soluble, and additionally as the inhibitors of EGFR and PPAR gamma. So overall, this shows that they are the good leads as inhibitors of EGFR and PPAR gamma. Further, the synthesized compounds, they were the pure form of the compounds was obtained, and they were tested, they were air dried and then tested for their purity by the melting point. So the melting point for compound A was found by the Thiele's tube melting point apparatus, that is 220 to 222 degrees Celsius, and for the compound B it was found to be 268 to 272. The crystal structures of the synthesized is determined to be monoclinic from the preliminary visual examination. So the compound A and B were found to be partially soluble in water and soluble in ethanol, methanol, and DMSO. And the compounds was maintained in DMSO, as the DMSO solvent allows easy solubility and they do not harm the cells during cytotoxicity testing. So the thin layer chromatography that was performed on the pre-coated silica gel and the spores that was and the spores that were produced was visualized by the iodine staining method. And the RF value was obtained for both of the compounds, that was found to be 0.6 for compound A and compound B 0.4. Further, by IR spectra, we could analyze the maximum resolution, and it was used to determine the functional groups. It is basically used to measure the vibration of the atom, and based on this, determine the functional group by FTR spectrophotometer. So as you can see, it gives us a clear view that the compound was of a high purity. Further, by in vitro cytotoxicity prediction that was carried out using MTT assay and recorded by ELISA plate reader, that is the BioRad microplate reader, was used to plot the log dose response percentage inhibition graph and to calculate the IC50 value to analyze the data obtained statistically by the graph by PRISM 8. So the OD that was calculated for compound A, the IC50 value was somewhere of 75.54 micromolars and 178.5 micromolars for compound B. Whereas the IC50 value for non-cancerous was found to be 341 for compound A and 351 for compound B. So the one-way ANOVA test for MTT results of MCF7 was carried out, and the p-value that was found was less than 0.05. So for compound A, the p-value was found to be 0.0191, and for compound B, it was found to be 0.0184. That was found to be less than 0.05. And indicating this all indicated that it has strong statistical results. And overall, the statistical results show us the 95% of confidence level. And the R-square value, which gives us the goodness of fit of the model, that should be somewhere near 1 or a value of 1. So for compound A, it was 0.3, and for compound B, it was 0.38. So yeah, again, it was following the R-square, perfectly fits the data. Hence, the MTT data that was obtained for MCF7M blood lymphocyte of the non-cancerous cell line, it was found to be reliable, and statistically strong valid results were found. So the higher the value of IC50, the higher is the dose that is needed to achieve the EGFR inhibition effect. So here we can say that the IC50 value of compound A was found to be 75.5, which showed to be potentially active and which was in the range of less than 100 micromolar, showing that there was significant changes in the cell density, and it increased the number of dead cells in MCF7 cell line toxicity analysis by MTT assay. Hence, the drug was found to exhibit a significant EGFR inhibition property. And it is also supported by the in silico docking results for compound A, thus, and it was also confirmed by in vitro experiment. For compound B with 178.5 that was greater than the range of micromolar, that is 100 to 300, it indicated a moderate activity, that is moderate changes in the cell density. Both the compounds showed greater than 300 IC50 values, indicating that there was no toxicity, even with an increase in the drug dose, along with no changes in the cell density or morphology. Therefore, no toxicity was observed on the non-cancerous cells in human body. So we can say that these drugs were safe to be used. So the mitochondrial activity, basically the MTT assay, is determine the survival of the cells at the toxic concentration with treated compounds A and B. So hence the increased cell viability is also linked in the formation of the relative amount of formazan. So the compound A and B decrease the mitosis and increase apoptosis, that indicate that there's a stronger toxicity with increasing dose concentration, suggesting that the targeting EGFR has broader downstream effect. Also, the graphical representation indicated that the addition of compound A and B at 25 UM revealed a very slight increase in inhibition in comparison to the cell growth, with no visible changes and constant cell density throughout the MTT assay. So we can say that overall, the compound A has shown to be more potentially active and triggering apoptosis and change in the cell density as compared to compound B with moderate activity. And it has been observed with the increasing concentration. Further concluding, an interesting class of benzoanalyte series with halogen substitutions was designed, synthesized, and evaluated for the in vitro anti-tumor activity against the MCF7 breast cancer cell lines. Molecular docking suggested that compound A and compound B had better binding energies compared to the already existing drug in the market, that is allotinib, and they complex with the EGFR in a very similar fashion to allotinib with extra binding interaction. Like I said, the pi sulfur binds that was present, that was observed by molecular docking. The toxicity prediction by Swiss ADME and EDMIPSA revealed that compound A and B were both found to be good potentially, but compound A had more impact than compound B. And they are good inhibitors of human EGFR and PPAR gamma in moderating the breast cancer and biological downstream signaling pathways. The compound A and B were synthesized and found to be pure solids with narrow range of melting points. And the FTIR spectroscopy results measured the vibration of the atoms and determined the functional groups of each compound. And the MTT assay that was carried out was validated by Graph Prad Prism A, which revealed the IC50 value, which was stated to be 75.5 micromolars for compound A, that is the most active compound, compared to compound B with 178.5 micromolar. It depicted the moderate activity, and which is also supported by the in silico docking prediction and thus verifying the in vitro analysis by laboratory method. Compound A, like I said, had a strong pi sulfur bind with MET-A742, and it is believed that it would trigger the downstreaming signaling through PI3K and AKT and the RAS-RAF pathway. Benzaline analogs have shown that they could be further designed for potent inhibitors of EGFR and can be against used for breast cancer. Additionally, further pharmacological investigations are needed to be done in order to evaluate these compounds as potential therapeutic agents against breast cancer. Future prospectives could include that the molecules could be tested further on another breast cell line, that is MDA-MB231, and the further cytotoxicity can be predicted for MTT assay. Further pharmacological investigation can be done using trifunctional assay, and PPR gamma transcripts can be used. Synthesized molecules can be further modified with and better interaction with receptor. Compounds can be also investigated for their DNA binding properties using UV visible spectrophotometry, and the cytotoxicity can be used for different assays can be used. These are the references that was used. Thank you. to all who was included. I acknowledge everybody who has been a part of this project, that is Dev Jani Das Gupta, the director of Deva Patil University of School of Biotechnology and Bioinformatics, Santosh Chajar sir of MIT Nasik, my guides Mala Parab and Dr. Mala Parab and Mr. Pramod Kumar Gupta, and to all the laboratory and staff members, to my parents. Thank you. If you have any further queries, you can reach out to me on any mentioned email IDs.